Hi, I'm Matthew from the Android Cloud team, and I'm going to talk about how your apps can efficiently use platform resources with the new job scheduler APIs, you lucky devils. So what are we doing here exactly? I mean, this is YouTube. You could be watching video game replays or fashion tips, but don't go just yet. I'm going to show off a new way to handle execution of background jobs in a way that will improve battery life and also developers' lives. So what background jobs? Well, there are different kinds of work your app needs to get done that aren't user-facing. Periodically hitting the network to upload user data or downloading config parameters. These typically don't need to be reflected immediately, if at all, to the user. For example, think of a network operation that would not update the UI. The types of jobs I'm talking about are also self-contained. One way to think of it is that we're interested in execution logic that can be easily refactored. Another way to think about it is that there's some bundle of parameters that you need to know to run your task. The name of your user, the list of rows in your database that are dirty, or the list of contacts that the user has requested be uploaded. So why create a new API? You might wonder at our rationale when clearly these things have been possible for as long as Android has been around. Well, not quite. Take network calls as an example. These are a strong candidate for the kinds of work we're interested in. Apps usually do them ASAP to kind of get them out of the way. This leads to unnecessary radio wake-ups where everyone is doing their own thing haphazardly. To tell you some more, let's take a look at how we might write code to periodically upload data, but without the job scheduler. There are about roughly two ways you could have done this. You could use a handler and post a delayed message if the period was small enough. But what happens if the user kills your app or if the system does? At this point, you decide the alarm manager is for you because at least you'll be started when the alarm goes off. The problem is now that if the phone turns off, your alarm is gone. So you're stuck doing your own persistence. Then what if an execution time, the network wasn't available? You'd need to handle this and try again later. You'd have to register a broadcast receiver so you'd know when connectivity came back. I guess you could try writing a sync adapter, which kind of solves a bunch of these issues for you. And it's an excellent piece of code, but it's not intended to be used for scheduling. Regardless of route, it would be a mess and difficult to get right. So we've decided to get it wrong for you. We've taken pre-existing functionality, wired it together with new functionality, and are giving it to you in a nice palatable package. We've introduced the concept of idle mode, a window of time for which the system has determined the phone is unused and is not likely to be turned on soon. For example, having a job run while the device is idle and also charging is likely to happen at night when the user is sleeping with the phone plugged in next to them. The second thing we've done is integrated closely with new system APIs that inform clients when the network is active. This means that the handshake with the carrier has already happened. So when we batch your app's network calls to follow on shortly after, it'll circumvent the battery cost of you doing this handshake independently. Less pesky battery blaming and battery stats for you, and more battery for our users. So let's take a look at how to use this functionality. Here we'll see the sorts of work you might like to express. Run this when the phone is plugged in. Run this whenever an unmetered network becomes available, but make sure I run within the hour. Wait at least 10 minutes and then run this the next time the device is idle. Every 15 minutes, whenever a network is available, let me know so I can do some small health check. These four use cases, there are a number of constraints, and you can specify as many or as few of them as you want. The scheduler will only run a job that has all of its criteria satisfied, the one exception being when you set a deadline. When this deadline expires, it'll override the existing constraints. Let's take a look at how we do this practically. For this job, we're setting the deadline of an hour. But what'll happen if the phone is in airplane mode after the hour has expired? Well, we'll talk about failure retry in the next and last section. For now, let's look at some other interesting things. My job service is the endpoint you provide. Here, you're identifying it so the system will know where your job should land. Wi-Fi upload ID is this handle on your job to differentiate it from others as you schedule. So arbitrary integer that you pick yourself. You take this job info object and you pass it into the system in the normal way, and voila. But where does my logic go? Okay, so you extend a service provided by the framework. The framework service handles all of the service lifecycle mechanics for you, leaving you with only the implementation of on-start job and on-stop job to worry about. Once your job has landed on your service, and you've done whatever it is you set out to do, call job finished, and you're done. And that's more or less it. Oh yeah, I mentioned it was really easy to request a reschedule if your job failed for some reason. In either on start job or job finished, you provide a Boolean to indicate whether you need to be rescheduled. Bam, done. Okay, that's a lot of detail, but if you're still with me, you have it and are ready to use this stuff. The takeaway is that being good citizens should be as painless a chore as possible. So, thanks for watching.